Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Wilson Cole with Adams, Evans, and Ross. Wilson is the founder and CEO of Adams, Evans, Ross, the nation's largest credit and collection agency designed exclusively for the staffing and recruiting industry. Mr. Cole was inducted into Inc. Magazine's exclusive Inc. 500 group for being the CEO of the 307th fastest growing privately held companies in America. Wilson was named the Billion Dollar Man by Recruiting and Staffing Solution Magazine for collecting more than $1 billion in past due debt over his career of almost 20 years. For more than 20 years, Adams, Evans, and Ross has grown to become the nation's largest credit and collection firm specifically collecting for the staffing and recruiting industry. Over the years, their collection process has been perfected to ensure maximum results for their clients at competitive rates. For staffing companies, candidates are the assets that drive revenue. In the current labor market environment, staffing companies are uniquely positioned to quickly source qualified candidates for their client companies. In today's session, Wilson will discuss backdoor hires, including case studies, common excuses, and effective rebuttals. By the end of this session, you'll know how to protect your revenue stream from backdoor hires on candidates your staffing firm presents to client companies. If you have any questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A feature located on the toolbar. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. With that, I will turn the floor over to Wilson.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you having us here for this week's conference. And as far as on the chat, I'm going to specifically pay attention to my slides. I don't multitask well. My wife is so much better at that than I am. But so I'm just going to focus solely on the slides. And what we're going to talk about is something a little different than typically. Typically that we do for the staffing and recruiting industry. In the past, we've always talked about, you know, credit prevention, how to create a great sales letter or a great collection letter, and just different ways to minimize your risk. Well, over the last, oh my goodness, probably about 10 years ago, we saw a huge surge, and we call it backdoor hires. It, over on the temp side, it's going to be more of the temp conversions or things along those lines, because half of our clients are staffing firms, half of our clients are recruiters. And probably about 10 years ago, we saw a huge surge, first started with the recruiting side. In the last year or so, we're seeing that same huge surge now over on the staffing side, and that is these companies hiring your candidates or converting your temporary in failing to tell you about them. So what we have done over the last 2 years is, A, we've written a book, and if anybody emails me, wilson@aercollections.com, I'll have our folks email you a PDF copy. We may even have some hard copies floating around here as well. But it's going to walk through something very similar to what we're talking about here. But we've also developed software that, you know, if you go to backdoorhires.com, it will kind of explain what we do, and it automatically tracks them. But one thing that is interesting is in the last 6 months, we have seen a disproportionate size of backdoor hires or temp conversions over on the staffing side, because we see it in collections. And the thing that I find interesting is we're kind of in new uncharted territory. I've serviced the staffing and recruiting industry since, since like 92 or so. So I think we're in like our 26th year. And we've never been at a 3.8% unemployment rate. And so a lot of the excuses, it used to be economic or where they were just trying to bypass you in the harder times, in my opinion, we're starting to see almost a systemic bypass of your candidate and going directly to them by HR departments, because HR departments are getting a lot of pressure to try to source this on their own. So what I'm going to do, Amanda, have you given me controls over the slides?
Yes, I have.
Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through the nine excuses, but we're also going to go through kind of what you need to do prior to it. And there's a general theme that we're going to kind of have going throughout the issue, and that is to get your paperwork signed. Before I'd send out any candidate, I'd always have your, whether it's your contingency or your employment agreement, you want some ownership in it. So what we're going to do as we're going through this, kind of keep in mind, I'm going to come back to why you need to have your paperwork signed per excuse, because in some excuses that argument's better than others, and also in some states that is better than others. So here we go. Let's see. Let me move this, if I may. You know, the top nine excuses, and we're going to kind of break this down for everybody, and we're going to give kind of a couple of examples on some of these, and we're just going to kind of drill down a little bit deeper. But those main excuses are, we already knew the candidate. Number two was we had the candidate's resume. Number three, we didn't sign an agreement. Number four, we paid another recruiter, or the staffing equivalent to that is they came in from another temp agency. The fifth one is we hired the candidate, but they didn't last 90 days. The sixth argument on that is the candidate called me back on their own. Number seven is we didn't hire him as an employee. We hired him as a consultant, contractor, you know, whatever they want to call him, but they're trying to say he's not a W-9, he's a 1099 or something along those lines, contractor. And number eight is we hired them for another position. And number nine is, yes, we hired him, but the other candidates didn't last as long, and so we in essence took a self-credit. So those are the main excuses that we hear. And so now let's kind of start drilling down. And Amanda, I am assuming you can hear me good and everything's clicking through as I get onto a roll here.
Yes, everything looks good.
Outstanding. Okay. On they already knew the candidate. You know, whenever a company tells you that they already know the candidate, a lot of times they're frustrated because their HR people may have had the resume in the database, or it was a competitor, or he worked there 6 years ago, whatever that case may be. And, you know, the most biggest argument that we hear is we already knew him. The fact is, if they knew the candidate, it's 100% irrelevant, because knowing someone or knowing that they're looking for a work is or looking for a job is two separate issues. So what you want in any of your agreements, and I'm going to give you tons of collection advice. We have an in-house attorney, but we cannot give you legal advice, but we can give you tons of collection advice here. And on your agreement, you want in there that if you present anybody, if they hire them within 12 months, a fee is owed. And so if you send in somebody and they say, well, John worked here 8 years ago, it really doesn't matter. Or if they were a competitor or they worked somewhere else, it absolutely doesn't matter. The best way to cover that they already knew the candidate argument is to have in your employment agreement or on your contingency-based agreement that if they present anybody, if you present anybody and they hire them within 12 months, a fee is owed. Sometimes they will request a name clearing period, and so, you know, if you have to put in there, they have, you know, 24 hours to let you know that that this candidate is already working or has interviewed with them in the last 14 days or something along those lines. But if you give them those preset conditions, if they're meaning to bypass it, they'll just simply recreate history and make that appear as the case. So the biggest way to tell them is if they are looking for any candidates, or if they hire any of your candidates within a 12-month period of time, a fee is owed. The excuse number two is we already have the resume. That's, in essence, a very similar argument to the we had the client's resume, or we already knew the client. You know, in the olden days, the argument used to be, well, we already knew him, or we already had his name. Well, if you had him in a phone book, would you still say that you had his name in a phone book, but you didn't know where he was? So having the resume, especially if it's a resume that they received 6 months ago, 5 months ago, is really irrelevant. A lot of times also, if you are talking to the candidate and you tell the candidate, hey, you know, this ABC company, we're going to be sending you over there, it's not uncommon for that candidate to run directly out to that company, you know, apply online, supply them their resume. At the end of the day, you were still the procuring cause. And procuring cause is going to be a little bit of a theme in an argument. And just in plain English, what it means is if it wasn't for your actions, that candidate would not have been there. So whenever they tell you that they know the candidates, or they had the candidate's name, it's going to be the same as we already knew them. They have to be able to show you that that they were actively involved. Now, if you present somebody that they interviewed last week, then they're going to have a pretty good argument. But in 27 years of doing this, I can count maybe twice that has actually happened. So what you want to do is, you know, like we were talking about, there's a very big difference when you send over the resume and they call you back 10 minutes later and they say, hey, you know, Fred Smith has already been interviewing and he's already going through it, then you probably don't have an argument. But we literally have this argument going on right now with our in-house attorney and a debtor's attorney, and they're saying, well, we already knew him. They allowed our client to set up three different interviews, and they're still trying to say, well, we don't owe him because, you know, we already knew him. So that is where that signed agreement is going to be key, as far as if you present somebody, it's open and shut. And so, you know, if you set up an interview, and also you can ask the candidate, have you ever applied? And I would always do that in email, because if you wind up having the candidate tell you on the phone, yeah, I've never applied to ABC Company, and they say, yep, yeah, he did, here's his resume, and it came in about the same time that you presented them, if you had a verbal conversation with him, you have absolutely no documentation. But if you've got an email where that candidate agrees that they haven't ever placed it, then that gives you a little bit additional argument as well. Let me come over here. On number three, we don't have a signed agreement. Now, number three, whenever I have a debtor make an argument, and the first thing that they say is they say, we don't owe it because we didn't have a signed agreement. I want you to think about that statement for about a half a second. Because what they are telling you is, yeah, I know I told you I wanted to move forward. Yeah, I told you to send me over their resume, but I had my fingers crossed. If the first thing that your former client tells you is, well, we didn't sign anything, I want you to know that that speaks volumes, and more than likely, from the beginning, they had no intention on paying you before at all on this. It just speaks absolute volumes as far as on what their intentions were. And I have clients tell me, well, Wilson, I can't get employment contracts or fee agreements signed before I send the candidate out there. Well, shame on you for doing that, because I can tell you half of my clients can get a signed agreement with no issue at all. So it's one of those issues to where that's something that you told yourself that probably isn't based in reality, or that's the way that you were trained. That is the quickest way to get around that argument, is to get that signed agreement. Now, they will come back and tell you, we'll send over folks and then I'll sign it later. If somebody's not wanting to sign your agreement in the beginning, that should speak volumes, absolute volumes, on why you should probably relook at it. Also, it solves a bunch of other problems going forward. But if you ever have a company tell you, I didn't sign the agreement, what I'd like for you to do is I'd like for you to pretty much end that conversation, because anything that you say going forward, they're going to try to utilize to not pay you. Because it's, and a lot of times it's not a money issue, it's a character issue, to where it's, yeah, I agreed to it, but my fingers were crossed. And, 90% of the time, they never intended on paying you. And we deal with, oh, my goodness, we're running hundreds of debtors through here every month, thousands every year. I can tell you, 27 years of doing this, my faith in humanity is at its highest level. 99% of the people want to do the right things. Even the ones that don't pay our clients, they never intended for it to happen that way. They just misjudged cash flow, life got in the way, poor management, whatever. It was never a character issue. But I can tell you, on this particular case, if the first thing they tell you, and especially if it is the person that you've been dealing with the whole time, tells you, well, we didn't sign anything, understand that is the only profile identifier you need. You're dealing with a bad guy. And so end any conversation, whether you get us involved, whether you get your attorney involved, you need to go ahead and move forward. Now, let me grab some water. Now, as far as on the signed agreement, in some states, you have to have a signed agreement or you don't have a deal. In the state of Massachusetts, their Supreme Court has ruled if you don't have a signed agreement, you simply don't have an agreement at all. Now, we sue through our forwarding attorneys all the time in the state of Massachusetts, but if their attorneys bring up the fact that you don't have a signed agreement, it gets it kicked out of court about every time they bring it up. A lot of folks don't realize that their Supreme Court has already ruled that way. So you want to have a signed agreement from the aspect of just covering the bases, because in some states, in Texas, it's not as big of an ordeal as it is, in Massachusetts. In New Jersey is just about as bad. So always have a signed agreement. It will eliminate 90% of the problems that you have on not getting paid from backdoor hires. And let me go ahead and jump over there. We paid another recruiter, or we paid another staffing firm. Whenever you present a candidate, they have a fiduciary duty to keep track of that candidate. So if your client tells you that they've taken your candidate, they've sent them over to another staffing firm, or you presented them, let's say they were working a temp job, you lost the contract for whatever reason, they bring in another staffing firm, that's a temp napping issue, and you certainly have grounds to recover that. If you are presenting someone, and let's say they go in where they were going to do direct hire, and then all of a sudden you notice 4 months later they're working there as a temp with another company, sometimes it's, you know as well as I do, these candidates may be working for several temp agencies at the same time. The easiest way to do that is to make sure that when you present, especially if it's for a direct hire, that you have that signed agreement that if they come back within 12 months and they're hired in any form or fashion, a fee is owed. Because a lot of times HR managers may, not a lot of times, there are instances where the HR managers will go ahead and send your resume out. If they don't want to pay for a direct hire fee, they'll send it out to a temp agency, and that temp agency will go ahead and hire them and bring them back as a temp. So it's a way for them to control their cost. And this is one of the more difficult ones to collect, because sometimes it's just, the instance where the guy's working or the young lady's working for several temp agencies and they show back in. There again, having that signed agreement will solve how that's supposed to spell out. But the biggest thing is that company that you're working with has a fiduciary duty to keep track of those candidates, especially on direct hires. And there have been cases to where we get involved and they wind up having to pay both recruiters or both staffing firms. So the other excuse is we hired the candidate, but he didn't last 90 days. The easiest way to get around this is there again with a signed contract that covers it, because the scenario typically is the client didn't work out, the hiring company still hasn't paid for the original candidate, and so they're not going to pay for the fee. The issue with that is in your agreement, it should say something like, you guarantee that candidate on a direct hire 60 days, 30 days, 12 months, whatever it is, but they have to pay it in full within, 10 days or 30 days. If they don't pay within that period of time, then they void the guarantee. Also, I always like, and there again, this is collection advice, not legal advice, is if the candidate doesn't work out, your sole remedy is replacement of that candidate. And those wordings are kind of magical, because in essence, when they say, well, we don't want to pay for the candidate because he didn't last 90 days, what they're wanting you to do is to, in essence, give them a money-back guarantee, and they just haven't paid you for it. The argument can also be that if they don't pay you within that 10-day period or 30-day period, and let's say they leave after 6 or 7 months, or they leave after 60 or 90 days, if they still haven't paid you, the argument is that you're still owed 100% of the fee, but there's no replacement guarantee because they voided the guarantee by not paying you within that time period. So as you go through this, I want you to make sure that you get them paid, because the longer that you have a direct hire fee out there that's overdue, the less likely you're going to get paid, especially if it's a company that's in economic challenge, because the same way that they're stretching you out, they may be stretching your candidate out, not paying them in a timely manner, not covering expenses, or your candidate looks around and sees the stuff that's going on and says, heck, I don't need to be here, and then they leave. So on direct hires, you want to get paid as quickly as you can. But you also want to make sure that if they don't pay you within that 30-day period, that guarantee is void. Now, the other argument that we hear is the candidate called me back on their own. Well, that's really kind of a variation of we already knew the candidate, a lot of times they say they call them back on their own. About half of them, we don't have a signed contract when that happens, which tells me the candidate may have called them on their own. They may not have called them on their own. All of that is absolutely irrelevant, especially with a signed contract that says if you hire our candidate within 12 months, a fee is owed. And they don't want to pay the recruiting fee because they say, well, they already applied on our on our own. And the problem with that is that you're still the procuring cause. Had you not made the connection with Fred Smith to whatever hiring company that you have, then they wouldn't have known, you know, to pick up the phone and call Fred Smith back. So if they pick them up and pick up the phone and call them back, you're still 100% owed a fee, and it's almost irrelevant from the aspect of they already knew them, because if Fred Smith called them back, or if they pick up the phone, then you know, it's still the procuring cause. So you're still 100% owed as far as on that. Excuse number seven is we hired him as an employee, we hired him as a contractor, we you know, hired him as anything but an employee. We hired him as, you know, if it's a direct hire, they hired him from a temp from some other company. The problem when you hear this is I want you to kind of view this the same way as when you hear them tell you that they did not sign anything, is if they tell you they hired him as a consultant, they hired him as a 1099, that should speak volumes on the character of the person that you're talking to, because what they've tried to do is they've tried to be creative on bypassing your fee. Now, the easiest way to do this is to make sure that you have a signed agreement that basically says that if they hire your candidate in any capacity, in any position, that would include but not limited to consultant, independent contractor, 1099 employee, which is the same as that. Also, we have found where they said, well, he opened up his own company and came back to us as his own temp. We've seen some really weird stuff when it comes to that. And so what you want to do is if they hire him or engage them in any capacity, in any position, that solves that particular excuse as well. But if you don't have a signed agreement, or if in your agreement it says if you hire him as an employee, then a fee is owed, we have had courts rule against our forwarding attorneys that say, well, you know, it says right here if you hire him as an employee and it's very clear that they hired him as a consultant or as a free agent or whatever, so he did not fit the employee bill, therefore a fee is not owed. And we have had judges rule against us on that. So what I want everyone to know is that you need to cover all of your bases in that agreement. And so that's one of the ways to do it. And if everybody stays with me at the end of this webinar, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you my email address or an email address that you can email, and we'll send you back a link with what we refer to as our resource vault. And our resource vault was created by our in-house attorney on the contracts from a collection standpoint that we like the best. And on direct hire and on temporary, there's certain things that we kind of like to see. I can't stress enough, we cannot, even though she's an attorney, we cannot give you legal advice. But what we have done is we've created a resource vault or best practices vault that if you take a look at it and then have your attorney review it and they can tweak it for your specific state, it will still wind up saving you a ton of time and money. And that's an absolute free gift from us to you, because we want everybody to be as covered on this as they can whenever they're dealing with somebody. Now, whenever we hear somebody say, gee, we hired them in a different position, if they hire them in a different position, this is kind of a cousin to, well, they called us on our own, we didn't sign anything or what have you, or we hired them as a, you know, contractor or what have you. They are looking for a way to get out of paying your fee. You know, we had somebody that had hired, was, they're looking for a sales rep, and they hired him as a sales manager, and they said, well, we don't owe him because he's actually a sales manager versus a sales rep, and so we didn't need him. Or it may run to where they say, well, you know, we were looking for a VP of sales, and, you know, quite frankly, this guy just wasn't qualified for VP of sales, So, you know, but we had an inside sales position available, and that's what we let it do. Or if you're doing temporary in a warehouse, or, you know, we had somebody literally just tell me yesterday, well, they were in the manufacturing. They said, well, we needed somebody over on the metal side, and he just wasn't qualified, so we put him over on the wood side. Well, where you put him is irrelevant. You're still getting financial rewards from it, and you're still getting financial gain from it. And so a fee is certainly owed. So if they put him in any position, in any capacity, a fee is owed. And, you know, the biggest thing that you have to kind of keep in mind is if somebody tells you that they, you know, put them in this position or that position and therefore they don't feel like they owe them or owe for it, the longer you talk to them, the less it is that you'll probably get paid, because you'll make a statement or a misstatement and they will try to turn it into how they don't owe. I tell all of our clients whenever, you know, or prospects, whenever they call us and they say, well, Wilson, should I turn it over? And I had one client, you know, about 3 weeks ago call me and say, well, you know, they're paying me, but they were supposed to pay me in, you know, 30 days, and now they're wanting to pay me a third, and a third over the next 90 days. Should I turn it over or what should I do? And it's like, dear God, don't turn it over. Take the money, because there's no reason to turn it over to us, you know, to save 60 days and have to pay, you know, 20, 25%, 30% if it goes legal or whatever the case may be. Go ahead and get it collected. The litmus test that I utilize for all of our clients is when they tell you they're not going to pay you because. As soon as you hear them tell you that they're not going to pay you because, at that point in the conversation, because if they say, well, you know, Jim or Jane, go ahead and send me over all your documentation and let me review it. And if it's their in-house attorney, it's even worse, because I can assure you that when they look at that information, they are not looking at it seeing how they have unjustly not paid you. They are looking at it to try to build a defense on why they don't owe it. So if they tell you that they're not going to pay you because, whether you utilize us, if you utilize another service, whether you utilize your local attorney, whatever the case may be, you need to go ahead and elevate, because anything going forward is going to weaken your position. So now excuse number 9 is, yes, we hired them, but the other candidate didn't last as long as we thought, so we were going to take a credit. Now, this one is one that is kind of unique. We run into it surprisingly more than I thought we would. But what they're basically saying is they may be a good customer, and you place a couple of candidates and everything's going along fine, and then all of a sudden you place a temporary, or in the temporary side, we see it more with the temp to perm, to where they'll have somebody, they'll get right there at the hours where they'll convert over, and then for whatever reason they convert over, and once the companies pay in them versus you, they leave. And so all of a sudden they start trying to reach out and grab your other candidates to kind of help make up the distance. And that'd be kind of like if I decided to go out and buy a car and it was supposed to last 6 years or 5 years or 3 years, whatever the case was, and it didn't last but, you know, 2.5. It would be like me going out to the car lot and, you know, after I ran up 100,000 miles on it and decided that I was just going to grab another car. That, in essence, is what they're doing. So what you need to do is there, again, have a signed agreement, and also be able to cover that topic in there, because if they are telling you that they were unhappy with something, you know, if it's a good client and you want to negotiate, that's fine, and I understand it. And it may be a situation where you had a temporary or a direct hire do some weird stuff, but if they didn't reach out to you to discuss it beforehand and they just kind of self-fund themselves, then they probably didn't have any intention on paying you from the beginning. Now, you know, as we cover these nine excuses, and we're going to come out with some answers here. I know, by the way, Amanda, have we had any questions come in? Because I cannot see the chat. I don't know if there's been any questions. If there are specific questions, now would be, a good time to send it to Amanda on that. If not, I have four or five questions that are always asked. So, Amanda, are there any questions on your end?
No, I don't have any questions from the audience yet, so go ahead and submit them now. And if you'd like to start, Wilson, with your commonly asked questions, and then I do have a few as well of my own, so go ahead.
Certainly. You know, the biggest question that we get asked is, well, you know, if I have in my contract, and we'll see this a lot more over on the direct hire, but there'll be some wording that will basically say, if you don't sign this agreement, your acceptance of our candidates show that you agree. Now, some attorney wound up putting that into the agreement as kind of a fallback position to where if a client doesn't get an agreement signed, then it gives them a fallback position to argue. What we have seen, though, especially with some of the national chains, is they'll point to that and they say, well, it says right there in my agreement, if they sign it or not, they agree to all the terms and conditions. And our in-house attorney probably made the best argument on that I've ever heard, and that is if you were going to get married and there was a prenuptial, and it basically said, hey, if you don't sign, you know, sign this prenuptial, if you don't sign this prenuptial and you still marry me, you agree to the prenuptial. I can tell you that prenuptial will be kicked out of court in about 15 seconds in most states. So having some wording that they agree to your terms and conditions by the acceptance is a good fallback position in case you forget to get the signed agreement. But you always, always, always want to have a signed agreement because in some states it's more and more of an issue. And especially in states like New Jersey and Massachusetts, it's a much, much, much bigger issue. The other part that we run into is a question is if they wind up bringing in another staffing firm and they hire all of my candidates away, am I owed a direct hire fee? And the question to that is absolutely, but you also need to cover that to where if any of your temporaries wind up working for them directly or through another agency, then a conversion fee of, you know, 20% of their annualized salary or $10,000, $5,000, whatever that magic number is, would be owed. Now, Amanda, you had mentioned, I got a few other questions, but you had mentioned that you had a couple of questions there. So what are your questions?
Okay. Now, you had just mentioned a little bit about the conversion. So let's say a company goes ahead and asks another staffing company to essentially take over your temporary placements that you have at a particular client. If you have a specified number of hours in which a candidate becomes eligible for hire with no conversion fee, would that negate any fees that would be assessed on those particular temps if they were moved over to another agency?
You know, it's really going to depend on how that math works out because if, in fact, you know, I've seen the agreements go a multitude of different ways. Sometimes it will say something like, you know, after you fulfill, you know, 480 hours, if you give us 30 days notice to convert the employee, then a fee is not owed. Sometimes it is automatic. So it's really going to depend on what the details are that argue that. And also, is it prorated? Let's say I'm going to use 480 hours as an example. If it's 480 hours, but they work 240, do they get a discounted rate? And those are things, those rules are the things that you need to cover in the agreements, because if one company says no, if you hire them under that 40 hours, then the full fee is owed, or another company say no, you only owe prorate, but neither one of them has a contract, who's right and who's wrong. So having that spelled out in the agreement is a very good thing. If you're using a practice management service, or if you're supplying through some type of vendor management service, those are things that you probably want to cover, because a lot of those vendor management agreements, they may have buried in on page 485 of those contract novels, to where after 6 months they can convert your employees. So it's all, what do you want those rules to be? And whenever possible, get your contract signed.
Okay. Another question. As you know, candidates can at times go out and become employees of various different, or put their resumes out with various different staffing companies. What happens if a staffing or a customer or client of a staffing company happens to receive the same resume from two different staffing agencies? Who is the prevailing
who would be the prevailing thing? We've argued that in collections, and we've argued that in with our forwarding attorneys on both sides of the fence. And the scenario is, one scenario is, let's say you and I are both staffing firms. I supply a resume, and then 3 months later or 3 weeks later, you supply the same resume. The argument could be that I made the presentation first, therefore whoever that candidate is who sent it in, or the company that sent in that candidate first, would be the one that would be owed. But let's assume, same scenario, I send it in and they say, no, we're not interested. You send it in and they go, yeah, we're not really interested. And you say, you know what, I think you're wrong. I think if you take a look at this guy, let me set up an interview. Let me get you in front of him. And his resume doesn't do him justice, or doesn't do her justice. I think he would be a huge add-on. You're going to see the same thing that I do. And let's say you set up that interview and your candidate goes in there and just knocks it out of the ballpark, and they call you back and they say, Amanda, you know what, you're absolutely right. He's perfect. She's perfect for the job. We want to go ahead and hire him. Now, under the hospice of, if I'm the first one to present that candidate, then I should be paid. But all of a sudden, you just went from sending in that candidate to getting them an interview, her an interview, and working it through. So we have argued on both sides of that. And that is where, in the agreement, there needs to be some rules with that hiring company, because that hiring company has its fiduciary duty to tell both of you guys, hey, Amanda, this candidate was presented 3 weeks ago already to us, and so they have a fiduciary duty to track it. Let me tell you what typically happens in scenarios like this is that, not always, but sometimes the company will go with you, and then our client find out 3 weeks, 3 days, a year later, and then it comes into collections because they can say, here, I'm the first one to do it. At times, those are scenarios where the company's had to pay both of the clients. But it really just depends on what those rules are. But the hiring company has a obligation, a fiduciary duty to keep track of that with some type of applicant tracking system.
Okay. Wonderful. Thank you for clarifying that. And another question. You mentioned New Jersey as being another state that may have specific laws that make things more challenging for collections. We have a lot of clients in the New Jersey area. Can you talk a little bit more about what those differences are and how they can protect themselves?
Absolutely. And New Jersey is one of those that if they are physically located in New Jersey, I am 90% sure. And if they're not, they need to run down and get registered. New Jersey is a unique state. And it's typically not problematic for staffing and recruiting firms that are in New Jersey because they already know it. But if for people that are just going to do direct hire in New Jersey or supply staffing across border, if they're in New York or Philadelphia or wherever the heck they are, New Jersey has a law on the books that basically says that you have to be licensed as a recruiter or a staffing firm in the state of New Jersey, or you cannot use their court system. Now, that sounds, okay, I can do whatever I want, and okay, I don't want to use their court system. Well, what that now means is if somebody doesn't pay you, you have absolutely no recourse to be able to sue them in the state of New Jersey or domesticate the judgment in New Jersey. You are absolutely defenseless now on anybody that doesn't pay you. And we ran into that in New Jersey is the only state that I'm aware of that has that issue. We ran into this probably about 8 years ago. We had our New Jersey attorney has been our forwarding New Jersey attorney for 22 years, has collected millions and millions of dollars for us. He got a defense that basically said, hey, we are going to have this thing dismissed because your client's not licensed in New Jersey. And the attorney immediately thought, well, okay, he's not registered as a corporation. We'll get him registered as a corporation or we can do something like that. And then come to find out there's a specific statute. They're not talking about corporations. They are talking about specifically being registered in the state of New Jersey. So when that happened, I went out to one of our clients in New Jersey, and he says, yeah, Wilson, I was one of the key ones that got that implemented back in the 70s because New Jersey wanted to elevate recruiters and staffing firms up to other licensed private or licensed individuals like attorneys, doctors, or what have you. And so we went and we had the New Jersey government passed this, you had to be licensed. And we were supposed to, you had to have so many continuing educations every year, and it was like a $200 fee. Well, the problem is, after about 3 years, New Jersey came back and said, yeah, we're tired of tracking this continuing education credit and all of that, so we're not going to make that part of the requirement. We're just going to make it the $200 or whatever the amount was for the fee. So if you are not registered in the state of New Jersey and you do business in New Jersey, you need to get registered in the state of New Jersey. If you email me, Wilson@AERcollections.com, and say, you just put in there New Jersey registration, I'll send you a link that kind of takes you back to that New Jersey website, and you can handle all the paperwork. Also, if you will email Samantha@AERcollections and put in the subject, Wilson promised resource vault. She'll send you a link to the resource vault with some of the forms and best practices that we like in there. But the biggest thing is with New Jersey is you have to be licensed. Also in the state of New Jersey, it's not absolute like it is in Massachusetts, but it's very, very, very close. You really do need to have a signed agreement. Also, with staffing firms, they may not get an employment agreement or an engagement agreement on the front, but they always have signed timesheets. On the back of the timesheets, it needs to be a mini contract. It needs to have all of this stuff that we've talked about on the back of those timesheets. That way, every time they sign that timesheet, they're agreeing to your terms and conditions.
Wonderful. So just to clarify, when you say registered in the state of New Jersey, we're not talking about business registration. You're talking about registering as an individual if you are a recruiter.
It's registering as a business, but it is a license. It's not like, you know, all states, okay, you have corporations, you have LLCs. This is not get incorporated in the state of New Jersey. This is you have to be licensed. If you're an individual recruiter, you got to, you know, whatever your company name is. If you're ABC Staffing Company, your company has to be licensed to do business in the state of New Jersey if you're a staffing firm or a recruiting firm.
Okay, thank you. And I do have another question that has come in. It says, if you do not have a signed agreement with a potential client and you market a resume to a direct hiring manager and they want to move forward with a candidate, is there any way around the disclaimers that companies are now putting on their websites? For example, for the protection of all parties involved, XXX will only accept resumes from recruiters if an executed agreement is in place at the start of the recruitment offer. Unsolicited resumes sent to them for recruiters do not constitute any type of relationship between the recruiter and that company and do not obligate the company to pay fees should we hire from those resumes.
Okay. That whoever put that on their website just described about half of the debtors that we're talking about as far as on this particular issue. The attorneys have gone out and what they're trying to do is proactively eliminate what you're doing. On that particular one, what's going to happen is if you supply that candidate and it runs through there, even if that hiring manager is talking to you, because our argument is, that's an internal policy. If your own people won't follow that policy, how is it going to legally bind our client? What they're going to point to is their website gives out public notice to anybody that goes there that you have to have a signed contract. So I can assure you that if you were to place or send that resume out, I mean, we can still run it through collections, but I know what their argument's going to be is that they have publicly notified everybody under the terms of what their conditions are, and you at the website, and you bypass them, therefore a fee is not owed. So an attorney has set up on their website and thrown out that disclaimer to specifically put you on notice that they're not going to pay without a signed agreement. If you have placed somebody and if you have not been paid, then certainly give me a call and we can talk about it, but you're going to be behind the eight ball. If you're just now starting, I would not do anything until I got a signed agreement.
Okay, great. I have a couple more questions that have come in.
Okay.
Does the company need to be in New Jersey, the client or placement firm? Or does the employee only need to be working in New Jersey for the non-collections clause to come into effect that you had talked about?
The way that I understand that is if the company is in New Jersey, that's where the problem is. If the candidate's in New Jersey and the company's in New York, then it doesn't matter. What happens is whenever you have collection cases that go into litigation, you typically have to sue them where the company resides. So if the company is headquartered out of New York, then that's where you have to go to sue them in the court. So at that point, New Jersey law is not going to apply. But if you had to sue them, let's say, in Edison or in Cherry Hill or wherever, then you'd have to go to New Jersey, and that's where they were headquartered. That is where that non-payment's going to or that non-being able to use the court system's going to apply. Now, we still have many, many cases that go through courts where our clients are not licensed. And we will – there was one that we just got paid on, 2 weeks ago. Unless the debtor's attorney brings that up as a defense, it's not a problem. In the last 5 years, they brought it up as a defense three or four different times, three or four different lawsuits, and it is an absolute defense. And what that means from what our New Jersey attorney tells us is an absolute defense is just what it says. There is no appeal. There is nothing to it. You gotta stop. And the lawsuit goes away. And so unless they challenge it, you can still run it through there. But the problem is, as more case law gets on the books, and somebody puts in New Jersey recruiting dispute or something along those lines, it pulls up all this case law, and they are making it much easier for the debtors' attorneys to find that code because it has been argued more in the past or more recently than it has been in the past.
Thank you. That has answered the question. Did you have any other questions that or typical questions you get that you'd like to cover for us today?
You know, the biggest question that I get is, okay, Wilson, how do I keep track of the candidates? And, you know, the way that you keep track of the candidates is keep track of the candidates. And a lot of people say, well, you know, I'll put it on if it's higher end. I mean, if it's manufacturing, somebody in a warehouse, they're not going to have a LinkedIn. But a lot of companies think, well, you know, I'll just put them on LinkedIn and I'll track them. The problem that we are finding is if somebody is going to try to avert your fee and knowingly go around and create a backdoor hire, what they will do is they will just simply tell the candidate not to check their LinkedIn. And there's other things that they can do as well. But what I tell all of our clients is find out once a quarter where these candidates are. Now, I'm not going to turn it into an infomercial, but we've got backdoorhires.com, which is software that goes out, and as long as we know the name of the candidate, the hiring company, and the URL, it's going to crawl their website. It's going to run 72 variations of their email address. It's going to go out and hit blog posts and social media, Facebook, and it will touch LinkedIn and let us know if that candidate's been hired. It's going out looking for, if it's John Smith and ABC Company, it's going out looking for that triangulation that connects John Smith to ABC Company, whether it's through email or, you know, he posted that he's working there on Facebook or he's on the website or something along those lines. But you do need to keep track of the candidates because an industry study showed globally $3 billion with a B, billion dollars of conversion fees and misplacements happen every single year to the staffing industry. That is huge. I tell all of our clients, you can typically find $25,000 to $50,000 a year in placement fees, whether you utilize, you know, backdoor hires or you utilize some system inside your own whatever. You can find $25,000 to $50,000 for a mid-size firm because about one out of every 350 presentations turns into a backdoor hire. So that's a statistic. You know, if you're doing 100 people a year on direct hire and you're staffing, then you're going to be every 3 years. On temporaries, those numbers, we don't really have a firm number on. I think it's going to be, you know, on the higher side of probably out of every, 500 temporaries or somebody that connects back with your candidate and you don't know about it.
Great. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and put up the contact information. Please feel free to reach out to Wilson directly if you have any further questions or would like to use his services for any collection-related accounts that you may have. Wilson, would you go ahead and repeat again the email address that the participants should use to get that link resource vault, which has some of that special contract language?
Absolutely. Email my in-house attorney on that. And as you get the email back, you'll see that we share the same last name. And I'm not telling her that I'll shoot her an email and tell her to keep an eye out for it. So she always loves it when I surprise her like that. But she's also my one of my middle daughters. But she's been with us the last couple of years. But Samantha is it's Samantha at AERCollections with an S at the end .com. Once again, that is Samantha at AERCollections.com. Just put in the subject field resource vault, and she'll send you a link. And like I said, I can't stress enough, we can't give you legal advice, but I can tell you 27 years of tracking debtors and issues down with our clients, we find that there's some stuff that we really, really like to see in contracts. And then as far as on the New Jersey registration, if you'll send that to me, wilson@aercollections.com, and just put in their New Jersey licensing. I know that we have an email floating around here that I'll have sent to you by either myself or somebody in our staff. And if you have any collections or if you have any questions, I'm always easy to reach at 800-452-5287. I'm at extension 6578. And, you know, hopefully you won't need our collections, but if you do, let me know. Or if you want to check out following up on the backdoor hires, it's backdoorhires.com. But I appreciate everybody joining me on this. And, you know, the excuses vary widely, but I can tell you that the difference between if it's a $10,000 placement or a fee, we typically wind up getting on average with a signed agreement about 92% of the time, or 92% of the funds are recovered, where if you don't have a signed agreement, our average is about 50%. And so 50% of what that fee would be. So $9,200 versus $5,000 is the difference between having a fee agreement signed or not. So always have it done with staffing. Make sure you put all those terms and conditions on the back of your temp form.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing those statistics and for giving the resources out to try and help position the staffing companies to secure their assets and make sure that they are paid for all the work that they do. Thank you again for all of your participation in today's webinar, as well as Wilson for sharing your knowledge on the backdoor hire case studies. We'll have a recording of this presentation available on our website at tricom.com. It's under the industry, it's under the resources Industry Insider webinar tab. Thank you again, and watch for more information on our next webinar session. Have a great day, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.